Om Shanti.
The song said that we should march along the pathways which Baba has shown to us. He has given us some direction. Where we have to go, what direction we have to take. The Srimad which he tells us is the direction, so that we may not be astrayed from our path. Hurdles would come, obstacles would be there, but in spite of that all, we should keep on marching towards our goal, steadfastly, consistently, and with a good progress. So that we have to do this thing within the time which has been set. Certain things can be done any time. Perhaps in those cases we have much more time. But in this case, the time factor is also given. There is a constraint of time. Within this period you have to reach the goal, to reach a particular stage. So the topic today given to me is to take up in this class is creating the stage that Baba expects of us. Now when we say that we have to attain or achieve that stage which Baba demands of us, asks us to have, what exactly does it mean? Because if we understand things with clarity, then we can make full efforts. If the things are vague to us, not clear to us, then our efforts also are not earnest. They are not full-fledged. They are haphazard, at random. We don't have any program, any system of making any efforts. Now what stage? What do you mean by stage? Actually, as we are now aware, we are students of four main subjects. So we have to attain our stage, a particular stage, in each one of those four subjects. So the stage means, in simple terms, the stage which will be the result of the stage in all these four subjects. Now first of all, what should be our stage from the point of view of knowledge, spiritual knowledge, godly knowledge? Then again, what should be our stage from the yoga point of view? What should be our stage from the values, the dharana point of view, the divine qualities which we are supposed to have in our life? And what should be our stage while we are doing service or as a person who is dedicated to service? What should our stage be? And the net result of this, in a few words, we have to sum up. What should our stage be? I think most of us do know what should our stage be in each one of these subjects. In various different ways these have been expressed. But just to refresh your mind so that we march towards our goal, I would just recapitulate them hurriedly as to what should be our stage in each one of them. Take for example the knowledge first of all. Baba says you should be master knowledgeful. Master knowledgeful. Which means you should not say that this point is unimportant. That point doesn't matter. For example, some people say, who was the God of Gita? The sermon which is now recorded in the form of Gita. Who gave that sermon originally? Some people think that this has nothing to do with our practical life, so we need not think on it. If we do not do it fully, doesn't matter. But Baba says that you have to prove this to the world. And this is a very important point, a turning point. Here in this point you have to defeat the sadhus, the Mahamandaleshwars, the Jagat Gurus. Because in all the ashrams in India, in especially the Hindu ashrams, the word ashram here is used in that context. They study the Gita, the lecture on Gita, telling that it was given by Krishna in a battlefield called Kurukshetra. When the fight had just to start, just a little before that. So this is wrong. So if this is wrong, then all the things which they have been telling are wrong. If you can prove this to them, it will be really wonder. They would say there is some authority who knows about it, who is telling them. So how can we say that this is unimportant? Nothing is important. We are students, and students are supposed to learn, and learn all what is given in our course, what is taught by our teacher, what we are told told in our classes. So from that point of view, we should be knowledgeful, because this knowledge is like gems. Every point of knowledge is like diamonds. If there are certain points less, Baba says, then your crown will have less diamonds. Your palace studded with jewels and gems, in your case, that will be less. Your stage will be less. That is why your attainment will be less. Every point is necessary. There should be no gaps in knowledge. Gaps should not be left. So we have to become master knowledgeful. Then another thing is, we should have complete faith in knowledge. Nishchaya buddhi. Nishchaya atma vijayati. Faith moves mountains. If we have full faith, then we should be victorious. There should be no worry, no problem. If we are defeated by any of our old sanskaras, that in itself shows that we are weak in some points, so that we could not give a good fight to that evil. That still is there in our mind, and we have not been able to throw it out, roots and branch. So knowledge is very essential, and from that point of view, we should be full, not half, not two-thirds, not three-fourths, or any percentage. Full knowledge and master knowledgeful, because knowledgeful is one, he is God. We have to be master knowledgeful. And then we have to have complete faith. Then there should be intoxication, spiritual intoxication. Not just knowledge. That knowledge should lead you to some stage. It should give you a kind of a feeling, a higher kind of a stage, in which you have bliss. You feel very happy. You feel that you have attained a very high thing, very precious, very valuable thing. That feeling should be there. That kind of intoxication should be there. And the feeling that God the Almighty, God the Knowledgeful is my teacher. Those who worked with great scientists, they generally boast of it. They say that we worked with Einstein or with Heisenberg or this or that scientist. Now, but who can be greater than God? If he is our teacher, that is the ultimate. So we should be feeling lucky, privileged, and that should give us a feeling of intoxication. How lucky I am, the most fortunate on earth. God is giving me knowledge. I am his student, learning directly from him. It's really great. So that feeling should be there. That should give you a higher stage, heightened stage. Just knowledge, theoretical knowledge, will not matter, because it should have some effect on your mind. It should change your mind, your attitude, your outlook, your ways of thinking, ways of doing things. If it is really knowledge, live knowledge, it should play a role in your life. If it is not doing that, it means there is some kind of a lack of understanding. There is something we have not understood. So there should be intoxication. Then student life is the best. Even if someone is working in an office, someone else is a housewife, someone else is a doctor in some hospital or running a private practice in law or in medicine, whatever be our profession, our calling, our duty, all the same, we should think we are students first and foremost, whatever age it may be. So that should give you a feeling, I am a student. The attitude should be such, the more you learn, the more you will feel that you have still to learn. There is so much still to learn. And that will give you the feeling that you are a student. That is what is meant by saying that student life is the best. Because that person is dead who has no interest in learning. Learning is a sign of life. Learning is living. Living is learning. As long as we live, we learn. And as long as we learn, then only we live. Otherwise, we are just a dead log of wood, nothing more than that. So we should have that kind of thing. Student life is the best. And then, also I should say, it is the highest knowledge. Avinashi Gyan. Let us realize what kind of knowledge it is. It is not philosophy, psychology, geology, biology, zoology, so many logies and ologies. No. You see, it is something unique. Nothing can be compared with it. It is integrated knowledge, which is the mother of all knowledge, from which all kinds of knowledge emerge. It is all encompassing, and it is eternal knowledge which rests in God, and when He comes, He reveals it to us, that pure knowledge, eternal and immortal knowledge. So the result of this knowledge is different. A person learns surgery, he is very expert in heart surgery, but then he dies. Then in his next life, he has to learn again from the very beginning. To go to school, to college, to university, to learn all this, then again to practice and all this. But this knowledge remains with you, the effect of it, the result of it, remains with you for 2500 years. So from that point of view, Baba says, Avinashi Gyan. Others are not Avinashi Gyan. They are Vinashi Gyan. They are only for one lifetime. Of course, they go with us as sanskaras. But generally our human nature is they forget, even in your this lifetime. Suppose some of you read higher mathematics. How much of it you remember today? Most of the things we forget, even in our own lifetime, because we have no chance later on in our life to use them. The result is that it becomes oblivious. We forget about it. And someone has to revive this. So then only we come to understand, oh yes, we understood it, we used to learn it. Those of you who read physics or chemistry or some other branch of knowledge, now if there is time gap, say of 40 years, 30 years, 50 years, you remember only a very little essence of it, not much of it. But in this case, the result is such that your life changes, and that stage of life remains with you for 21 generations, for 2500 years. So remember, this is Avinashi Gyan. You should be feeling like, having that feeling. Highest knowledge being given by the highest teacher, leading to the highest status. Highest status. Highest status, what can be highest status? In which there is absolutely no peacelessness. There is no unhappiness. No misery, no sorrow, no suffering, no untimely death, no disease, no accident, no worry, no problem, so on and so forth. So many are the results of this kind of knowledge. No other kind of knowledge gives you this kind of thing. They can at least bring you some money or give you some expertise in some particular profession. But not all these gains which you very much require in life. It is this, it is this. It is this knowledge which gives you all this. So if we remember, this is that kind of knowledge which I am learning, so what will be our stage? Our stage should be determined by this kind of feeling. Then Baba says, never forget your goal. Laksh, your laksh, your ideal. What you want to achieve? You want to become like Narayana, like Lakshmi. This is the net result of this education, you see. An engineer who studies at an engineering college, he thinks that later on he becomes an electrical engineer, a civil engineer, or some other kind of engineer. He has that goal. What is an engineer? But to be like Narayana, like Lakshmi, who has all the divine qualities and is the greatest on earth in terms of the higher quality of life, higher quality of feeling, higher stage, that is my goal. So it should not be only knowledge which is just what you listen or you just note, but you should not, it should be so deeply etched in your mind that you forget, you should, must not forget what your goal is, what your ideal is. Oh, I am going to become like Narayana or like Lakshmi, who are worshipworthy, who have all those qualities. So that kind of feeling you should have as a result of that knowledge. Then the stage is determined by our study. A student means one who studies. What does study mean? Study means that you pay your attention to something which brings you learning, wisdom, new knowledge, new information. That is what happens when you study. Enlightenment, you can say. You can give other names according to the kind of knowledge which you are getting. Some of it may be mere information, but in this case it may be something different. Enlightenment, people call it. So when you just study, study it daily. Study it daily. This is the highest stage, because anyone who has realized how wonderful this knowledge is will never miss, because he will feel, this is the object of my life. Without this, as the fish cannot live without water, I cannot live without it. This is my very life, you see. So anyone who misses the classes or does not study means that he does not understand the knowledge or its worth or its the wonder it has or the results to which it takes us to or the achievement which it promises us or the prospects which it gives us. We are not aware of it. Then only we can miss the class. Else how can we do? There may be any hurdles in the way, see, and we must never, never miss our study. Shiv Baba comes daily from Paramdham. How far away is Paramdham? And we cannot come from this distance, that distance, or this place, that place to study. It is how funny it is. The teacher comes from such a far off place to give us that beautiful knowledge, and we just sleeping in our bed thinking that tomorrow we study. Today we let me take rest because I slept late in the night, you see. What is this kind of a student? What will you call it? Lazy. Lazy student. Not student at all, but lazy, you see. So then again, churning. Churning. Unless and until you churn knowledge, you go into its depth, you understand it, its pros and cons, its all aspects, its all dimensions, its full, in full perspective, then you don't understand at all, you miss certain things. It is multidimensional thing, actually. If you are pay attention, you will find it is so much. One point is full of so much wisdom. You can just, if you like, dwell on it, and you can feel that it is the whole ocean of knowledge, just one point of knowledge, you see. Books can be written on even one point of knowledge. It's tremendous. So unless and until I churn, how do I gain that happiness, that joy of knowledge, which knowledge gives us? So this should be our stage from the point of view of knowledge. These are some of the things which I have given you. Now from the point of view of yoga, Baba says be double light. You should be double light. Double light means have no worry, no fear, no problem. Baba is with me. All things will naturally in course of time be resolved as per drama, you see. Subject to conditions, they will be resolved. So I added to it as per drama, you see. Baba is with us. Yes, Baba is with us. Things will be resolved. Yes, they will be resolved because Baba is with us. But remember, as per drama, you see. Don't say later on they were not resolved 100% as they expected, because Baba also has to see drama, you see. He says you have been doing certain things in the past. You are carrying that karmic load with you. I can help you to an extent, but you are yourself a beast of burden. Carrying all that burden on you, what can I do? A donkey cannot be changed into a cow, you see. Can it be? What can I do? I can wash the donkey, but I cannot make it cow. This is the best you can do. So Baba says, be double light. Feel light and also just feel illumined that I am a point of light. Feel that kind of awareness. Previously, we were aware of Akash, this ethereal world, surrounded by what they call the ether. Some people say there is ether, others say there is no ether, you see. But in terms of Hindi or Sanskrit or in Baba's language, we say Akash, you see, space. At some places, space looks to be blue because of certain reasons. However it may look, when the sun rises, at the point of that rise of sun, it may look not blue, but golden, you see, like that kind of thing. But this thing appears, this background comes in our mind. Now you should feel light. You are in a sea of light. You are light, as if the flame of a candle, if it could speak, it would say, I am light. Moreover, it is having an aura, a light, certain light, which is radiating around it, you see. So you should also feel there is some light surrounding you. You are also light, and then there is an envelope of light, or light around you, so to say. You are moving in light. That kind of thing, that kind of feeling should be there. And such should be your state that people should see Baba in you. Actually, such should be our high state, that they see Baba in us. Our face disappears. When they look at our face, peep into our eyes, we vanish from their sight. Instead, Baba appears, who is self-luminous. And they are surprised. I was seeing originally some different person, but here now in that place is altogether a different one. Who is he? He may ask you after it. You were not there later on. Where did you go? There was someone else in your place. He appeared in your face. What was it happening? You seem to be a magician, you see, a unique magician. So our stage, finally, ultimately, the highest stage should be such that like Baba, like Son, like Father, like Son. If we are just having yoga, 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 you put iron into fire, the iron also begins to shine. It also becomes like fire, hot like fire, and also begins to emit light like fire. So if we have yoga, 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 what should happen? We should also be light, light, light. You see. Baba says there are certain stones, you know, in India, Shivling or Saligram. Generally, these are the stones which are taken from some rivers, banks of some rivers. where the water waves from the river come and strike the ocean, strike the stone again and again. Strike again, strike again, strike again. This side, that side, that side. Today, tomorrow, a day after, maybe for years. And then it becomes perfectly in that shape. You have not to use any sandpaper to make it smooth. Not to use any instrument to make it such so that when you put your hand on it, it's just become, it's a slippery surface, so to say. Those waves have been working on it, like the person who does the carving with chisel and hammer. Those waves have been working on it. So the water wave striking the stone ultimately make the stone worshipworthy. It becomes Shivling. Shivling has got a white kind of a thread around it. A special stone. It is because of the waves striking again and again. They select it, bring it to temples, use it for worship. It is special. So when we also again and again are in yoga and that light and might strikes on this soul, it breaks the crust settled on our soul and it washes us again and again, purify that, and then the result should be that we should become like that, you see, gradually. A little more today, then higher stage tomorrow, so on and so forth, step by step at least. It's not that all of a sudden when I sleep in the night, in the morning, people come to me and they say they are seeing Baba in my face. You see, Baba alone can do that miracle. But if I am to make efforts and to achieve this result, I should march on this. I should be conscious of this, whether I am becoming this. If I am not becoming this, then I am not being washed. I am not being heated, not being melted, not being changed, not being purified, you see. That process is perhaps not taking place. It has stopped. I should therefore be aware of it and make full efforts for it. Therefore, Baba says, people see Baba in you. You should become such. And then when you are in the meditation, deeply stabilized in meditation, or alone, or in a group, Amrit Vela, or at the twilight, when the evening is coming and the sun is setting, or at any point of time, when you have strong love in you for Baba, when you feel that you must stabilize your mind in His awareness, in His consciousness, then your stage should be Karmatit. Karmatit stage. You should totally forget your body, be above all kinds of thoughts, absorb totally in His consciousness, so that you are alone with Baba. There is no third person in between. Like people who are worshipping some idols, if all the time some human beings are coming in our mind, that means we are also worshippers of idols, idol worshippers. We are also having images in the temple of our mind. You see, but let it be alone, let us be alone, no one else, no interference, no interruption, me and my most beloved Father alone. Let us talk to each other for a while, be together, have a feeling of each other. Once in a while at least, when I have understood Him, I love Him. If I don't have this, what else do I have it? What is the life worth then? So we should be making sincere efforts toward this Karmatit stage or seed stage, as Baba calls it. In many Muralis earlier, Baba has been emphasizing that you should have Karmatit stage or Bij Avastha, seed stage. Then all your actions of like a yogi should be Yukti Yukt and Yog Yukt. What does it mean, yukti yukt? They should be correct, accurate. Accurate. There should be no failings, no faults. But they should be as they should be. According to Baba's instructions. This is an art. An artist does something which is excellent. In factories also, when you just give the management course to them, you say one of their goals is excellence, achieving excellence. So in our karma, the yogis who also do efforts, make certain worldly things, work in worldly fields, there should be excellence. How can we be perfect unless and until our work is perfect? God is perfect. So therefore the creation which he does is also perfect. Golden age is a perfect age of perfection because God is perfect. An imperfect person cannot create a perfect thing. And a perfect thing, perfect one person cannot create an imperfect thing. So it is a sign of perfection. If my work, my output, the result of my work is excellent, beautiful, at least good, then I should think that it is yukti yukt, it is yoga yukt. Then Baba says nirantar yogi, constant yogi. It's not just yoga just for half an hour and 4 hours no yoga, then again 15 minutes yoga, like a person has to take medicine after 3 hours, every 3 hours. So I also take a dose of yoga every 3 hours, 4 times a day. Or when there is traffic control, I just take these homeopathic pills, you see, for a while, and that's all. So this is not yogi life, not yogapathy. It may be homeopathy, allopathy, or whatever pathy. But yogapathy means it should be constant pathy, yoga. Then Baba says that will be the final stage. If you can't have this, you will perhaps not have this, unless and until you have worked hard, done lot of effort over a period of time, for many years, then only it will come. Not so easy, you see. What I have said about karmati, davastha and seed stage. So he says, before that, at least have it for eight hours, you see. Okay, even if you can't have it for 8 hours, Baba said recently, at least have it for 4 hours. So he is giving us so much concession, you see. You can't pay this much money, I say, okay, I give it to you, give me this much. You don't want to pay anything and you want to get it, you see. So you have to pay. When we went to America for the first time for this godly service, I was just having some literature of the institution. And an American gentleman, he asked me, how much have I to pay for this book? I said, no, nothing, you see. Because in those days, we used to give everything free, you see. Teaching of yoga free, literature free, everything free, you see. So I told him, it is free. He laughed and he said, my dear friend, nothing in this world is free. I said, but this is free, I am telling you, you can take it, you see. He said, but you should know someone has paid for it. Someone has paid for it. If I don't pay it, at least someone has paid for it. You have spent on paper, on printing, on binding. You have brought it from India, transported it to this place. Someone has paid it, you see. So he gave me another side of economics. He said, nothing in this world is free. You always pay something, you see. When I am in a position to pay, why shouldn't I pay? I want to pay. I am a person, I have a lot of money. So I don't want it free. But I told him free, not realizing really that nothing in this world is free. On that day I learned it from him that really what he says is correct to a point, that nothing in this world is absolutely free. So we also want to have the stage and the result of it, without making any effort, without paying anything for it, either the time or the energy or the attention. We want to achieve the result, saying that let it be free. Baba wants to give it free. No, please. You have to spend at least something. Then Baba says, you have not only to remember me. Yoga does not mean that you have to remember only me. You always say, yoga means link with God. Yoga means remembering God. Yoga means soul consciousness and God consciousness, and so on. But Baba has been elaborating this point and telling us that you have to remember three things. These three things make yoga. One is drama. If you forget the drama, you can't remember Baba. Because so many things will happen in your life that you will become worried, or you will have anxiety and fear. You will have insecurity. There will be moments of sorrow in your life. Somebody misbehaves with you and you feel insulted. So many things happen. If you don't at that time remember drama, your yoga is also gone. Because drama is gone. So you have, in order to, yoga stands on something. Yoga is based on something. In order that you may be in link with Baba, you must remember drama, you must remember soul, you must remember God. If you don't remember I am a soul, you can't remember God. So you can't be aware of Baba or have yoga with Baba if the rest of the two things are absent. In order that, why we say generally that we forget again and again? Why do we forget? If you just try to analyze the situation, you will find that either you forgot the drama at some point of time, or you forgot that you are a soul, you became body conscious. So Shiv Baba cannot be remembered. Naturally you will forget Shiv Baba, because it is the soul which has to remember God. And it is the drama that Baba has come at this point of time to give it to us. And certain things which are happening in our life are according to drama. Vah drama vah. Baba again and again says, Vah drama vah. Vah Baba vah. Vah re main vah. You remember these three things. Vah re main vah. How wonderful I am. I am also wonderful. Not me, but you all. So, how wonderful I am. Vah, Baba, Vah, how wonderful is God, and how wonderful is drama. You must remember not all those wonders of the world, six wonders of the world, but these three greatest wonders, which the world does not know, you see. So this is the stage of yoga, which we have to attain. And then what about dharana? What should be our higher stage in dharana? One is, that we must be completely surrendered. Completely surrendered, completely dedicated. Nothing is mine. I am Baba's, Baba is mine. That should be the pivotal point. That should be the thing on which my actions are hinged. Everything moves on this, my life. The whole pattern of my thinking is based on this, you see, for Baba. Then everything should be accurate and alaukik. Whatever you do, just pay attention. Is it just something which you are doing worldly, like other people do, or like what yogis should do? If you are doing it like yogis should do, then your dharana is there. There should be some quality, some divine virtue reflected in it. Some value should be reflected in it. Some spirituality should be reflected in it. Otherwise, that would be the work only of a body conscious person. So that means I have no dharana, learned nothing good, nothing new, but Baba wants us to learn. So it should be alaukik. And then accurate. It should be accurate. What words I have to speak to whom and when is essential. Not that you have to speak. They say communication gap, for example. Not only communication gap, sometimes communication creates gaps, I tell you. If you just talk in a rough manner, then you are creating gaps which were not there earlier. A great gulf you are creating. So what you have to speak, when you have to speak, and how much you have to speak, what should be the words you have to speak, you should know. Similarly is the case with all actions. All your actions should be accurate. There should be service in them. It should show that you are a spiritual person, that there is spirituality in it. And your mind should be for the betterment of the other people. Kalyankari. I am Vishwa Kalyani. I am to give the benefit of this knowledge to all. I am world server. That should be your idea. So then your actions will have that dharana. Otherwise, no. Then Baba has been saying that we should have no name and fame. That is actually the cause of so many troubles. It is a separate subject if we deal with it. Name and fame causes great struggle in life, in politics, in economics, in professions, in home, everywhere, you see. The lust for name and fame, glorification of the self. Instead of glorifying God, I want that I should be glorified. I should be glorified. Just to puff up my ego, to give something to ego, I want these things, you see. Like a person who would take peg after peg of wine in order to have intoxication. More and more I am feeling better if I am, you see, if being praised. If people flatter me, I will become more fat rather than by eating, you see. Then Baba says, in dharana, you should be simple and example. Simple and example. And you should be like showpiece, like the company or the factory which produces some goods, puts it on the floor in a showroom so that people can see what it is like, and you just make a display of it. So also, you should be such a person so that people ask you, where from you learnt it? Why you are always happy? How is it possible with you? We are not able to be free from tension, but we never see that you are in tension, and so on. So our life should be exemplary. And why simple? Because if we are not simple, it means that we have a lust for certain things. We want things. If we crave for things, we want things, that means we are not full. If we don't feel full, it means there is something lacking. It means I have not attained the highest thing, which is the highest treasure in life. The most precious thing in life I have not been able to attain. Otherwise, I should have contentment. I should be totally satisfied. You see. That shows dissatisfaction. So that I have to run after things rather than things run after me. I have to enter into a rat race with others to get things. That will never end. So, this is for dharana. Then in service, one who does not get tired. Athak sevadhari. Baba says, athak sevadhari. You do not tire of service. Service, service, service. Nothing but service. My life is for service. This should be our feeling, our motive. This should be the feeling of working. We work not for any other reason, to show somebody that we do it, or to get some kind of a praise, but because we feel we owe so much to others. And Baba has given us so much, so much, so much, that we must give it to others. We cannot be without it. There should be a deep urge in us, which we cannot curb. It naturally manifests itself and leads us to do service. We jump into the fray of service, not by somebody's asking, but because we cannot remain without it. Service is our very life. So service, and without feeling any tired out of it. And then Baba says, Haanji, always learn this lesson. Haanji. Someone says, can you do this? There is no one else to do it. I depend upon you. Never say no. I have headache. I want to take rest. I am already tired. You ask somebody else. You always think of me. You are killing me, so to say, torturing me. How much service can I do? I am a human being. I also have blood and bones. You mean to say I am not made of steel after all? Not of stone. I was born to human parents. So you are very cruel. You don't mercy on me. Not that kind of thing. But Haanji. Haanji. Yes, I will do. That should be the lesson you learn. And then always think, I am the most obedient servant. Never be proud of it. I do so much service. I opened so many centers. I organized so many conferences. I did this, that, and the other thing. Always boasting of service. This is not service. Baba says, Gupta service, hidden service. Don't make a show of it. Don't do any publicity. Don't make advertisement for you. Then again, you do service for your self-glorification. It means service should be for service. Because this person is peaceless, I thought I should be able to help him out of this situation. I am his brother. He is my brother. We are children of the same Father, God. God has been merciful to me. So I thought, it came into my mind, I must do this service to this person. Why should I be asked by somebody to do it? Why should I feel tired about it? When the world is suffering from some disease, some starvation, some earthquake, some catastrophe, some calamity, people rush. Those people who are social minded, they try to help people out of situation, out of the debris, to give them something to eat, to rush them to hospitals, to do service to them. Even they do. And now that the whole world is burning in vices and people are so sorrowful and suffering, I just sit. Can I rest? Baba woke up in the night. How should this message go to all the people? We are passing time. Time is getting more, less and less. And within this time, the message has to reach all over the world. You should think of new methods. He used to call me also. He woke up in the night, he could not sleep. He said, can't you hear the people crying? Oh God, give me peace. Oh God, give me some wealth. I am a very poor person. God, give me some health. They are crying, all of them, asking God, their Father. And we here are deaf and dumb, and stone deaf, not hearing anything at all. So we should pay our attention to it. They say that you can hear the voice if it is within a particular range. You see, the vibrations are such that you can hear them. Every one of us has a range of sight, range of hearing. So, but those who have a heart, those who have some emotions, those who are alive to the world situation, they should feel moved, you see. We must feel moved. Baba says, you are world mothers. When the mother just listens to a small cry of the child, when it begins to weep, she rushes to the child, leaving everything else. My beloved child is weeping, you see. So much is she careful. And anyone you love in this world, you always try to help, provided you think that you must do it. Similarly, in this case also, service for service sake. They say art for art sake. That is humbug. Not art for art sake. What do you mean by it? But I say service for service. Service because it is service. Now, these are some of the stages which I said we have to attain. These are just to refresh your mind, which you already knew about it. Baba has been saying it so many times in Murli, much more. I have just given few of these to you. And Baba also says, in short, follow Baba and follow Srimad. Your stage will be fine. Summing up all these, Baba just gives us one statement for our practice, our efforts. In order to attain the flying stage, Urti Kala or Charti Kala, the rising stage, Baba says, you must follow Srimad and you must follow Baba. Enough. Even if you just remember this statement inspires you, you can work well. You can attain this stage. And then add to this another thing. Baba has been asking again and again, children, beloved children, sweet children, be ever ready. I will not tell you on what date, what time the destruction will start. You are already seeing the things are ready. But I am asking you, children, are you ready? Should I now change over to golden age? Are you ready? I am waiting for you. How long you want me to wait? For years and years I have been waiting. I went to Avyakta Dham, to the subtle world, to call you, to make you subtle. Angelic. Because if I am in corporeal form before you, you have the habit, In life after life, you have been conscious of the physical, and you will also be conscious of my physical form. So now I attained because this form, this subtle form, angelic form, Avyakta Brahma, just to help you to attain that angelic form. When will you become angels? One of the stages which Baba is saying is to become like angels, Baba has been saying. So when will you become angels? Children, be ever ready. Time left is very small, very short. Later on, don't complain, Baba, you didn't tell us beforehand. Again and again and over again, I have been reminding you. How many times do you need to be reminded? Even the Indian government, which is the most lazy government in the world, which does not listen to your applications, just throws them in the garbage, in the waste paper basket. Even if you just go on reminding, sending reminders one after the other by registered post, by faxes, by other means, one day it wakes up, you see. And Baba has given us so many reminders. Have you kept any count of it? Just read the Muralis from so many years. He has been saying, be ever ready. Open the book on Avyakta Vanis and you just take notice of it. Since when he began to say, children become ever ready? You see. Not to say ever ready, we are not even ready. You see. Ever ready is out of question. But even ready is something expected of us, which is more than what we can do. What is to be done? So then Baba asks us, okay then, when will you be ready? Don't you wake up, you see. Now, I would take to simplification. You must have studied, all of you, mathematics, if not higher mathematics, elementary mathematics, mathematics in secondary schools, you see. There were questions on our arithmetic, known as questions of simplification. 5 multiplied by 10, then there is bracket, this minus this raised to the power this, then the bracket is again multiplied by another, and so on and so forth. It is a big line, you see. And then we are asked to simplify. And the result is 2, 5, 6, 7, that's all. So many figures vanish ultimately, and the result is very small. This in arithmetic is called the process of simplification. So many things I told you. So many things Baba also told you. Now I just take to simplification, like in arithmetic, you see. Now simplifying all this, the other day in Avyakta Vani, Bab Dada said, children have ruling power. He has simplified it for us. Okay, do this, do this, do this, do this, do this, do this. If you can't do anything, have ruling power, you see. At least you have to do something. So now he has made it so simple and given this simple statement of 3 words. Have ruling power, that's all. A small baby also can remember you if you just, the mama asks the baby to say, have ruling power, have ruling power, have ruling power. Even the parrot can say, you see. And when I was in Australia staying with somebody, when we came back home, he and me together, then the parrot which he had, he would say, David, you have come. David, you have come. The parrot would say, you could easily understand what he is saying. David, you have come. He had learnt, you see. So even if we, because there are 2 kinds of parrots, Baba says, I have no experiment with it, no experience of it. Baba says one is with something around that blue, you know, around the neck. Others are without that sign, that blue sign around the neck. So Baba perhaps makes this observation, I don't know, you see. So he says, those who have that kanthi, that something around their, a mark around their neck, they can learn. Others who don't have, they can't learn. So even if we were parrots, let us be at least those parrots who are with a kanthi, who can learn these 3 words. Have ruling power. Have ruling power. When you get up in the morning, say, Baba, good morning, I will have ruling power. That's all. When you sleep, go to the bed, say, Baba, good night, I tell you, I assure you, I will have ruling power. Say that. Just remember this small thing, have ruling power. What do you mean by having ruling power? Because I told you that even every point is an ocean of knowledge. Just, this is simplification. But before the simplification, that arithmetical question is so much, you know, if you write it. Now, what do you mean by ruling power? What are you supposed to have? What does a ruler have to do? What kind of ruling power you are supposed to have? A ruler commands things. One who rules, who issues the orders, gives the commands, this must be done, it will be done, you see. So you should have commanding power, the ruling power, that is, that commanding power is the ruling power. There may be a ruler, he has all the paraphernalia of a ruler. He lives in a palace, he has a lot of military, he has his robes and dress like that of a king. His treasures are full of diamonds and gems. All other things are there, but nobody obeys his directions. He is not a ruler, you see. Because his word does not work. His currency is not honored, you see. So, if you want to be a ruler, it means you should be able to command, you see. What are you supposed to command? So, there are certain things which you have to have in order that you can command. In this case, as Baba is using it in spiritual terminology, one is to start. When you want to start a thing, you can start. Baba says you want to raise your arm. You tell the arm to rise. The arm rises. The arm does not say no. You see, mind rules all your physical organs. It commands all your organs. I am sitting here. I decide I want to go. Actually, I don't want to go. Don't think that I am willing before completing it. But let me suppose for a moment I say to myself, I want to go. My feet, first of all I stand, then my feet begin to move in a particular direction. Where I left my shoes, I put on my shoes and so on. Everything begins one after the other. So start. When you want to command a car, first of all you start. You see. So you should be, when you have the commanding power, the ruler power, whatever you want to start, you should be able to start. You want to think of Baba at this time. And instead of Baba coming to your mind, something else is, some gulab jamun or rasgulla is coming to your mind. Maybe ice cream is coming to your mind, you see. So you are not a ruler. The ice cream is ruling you, not you ruling the ice cream, you see. So, in order that you may be a ruler, you should be able to command. And in order that you may be able to command, it has certain signs. One of these is that you should be able to start. When, what, the way you want to start. I think of subtle world. This is the thought I want to start. My meditation process, I should be able to start. I want to write. I should be able to do it with concentration. Otherwise, concentration cannot come. Concentration is very essential for meditation. And meditation and concentration is possible when you are able to control. So, Baba calls it controlling power or commanding power or ruling power. And that means you should be able to start whatever you want to start, when you want to start, the way you want to start, as long as you want to keep it starting. You see, number one. Number two is to hold. I think of Shiv Baba. This is how I start. Then I think of soul world. I think of Shiv Baba. The golden red light there. Now I want to hold my mind there. Let my mind not come back to this world, to the kitchen, to the study room, to the bedroom again. Let it be there with Shiv Baba in Paramdham. You see. So, the second commandment is that I want mind to hold. In any system of yoga, it is essential to hold your thoughts. Mere concentration is not enough. If your concentration lasts just for a few seconds, and then again your mind fritters away, it runs amok, here and there it goes, then it is not that quality of concentration which is essential, which you want to need. Hold. You ask somebody, stop. He should stop, you see. You go and do this work. He should immediately go and say, yes, sir, I do it, you see. That kind of command, then only you are a ruler. So the first is to start. The other one is to hold. Then the third one is to restrain. To restrain. Suppose I am talking to somebody. He is also giving me some response. I am listening to him. But he is using such rough language, impolite language, rustic language. I feel very bad about it. I want to say something to him in a very little harsh way, you see. I hold my mind. I should be able to hold my mind. Don't do this. It will spoil relations. And there will be enmity, estrangement. So many bad consequences. It's better to keep silent. Or if I can't keep silent totally, I want to tell him something, but with restraint. I don't just want to burst out, you see, with restraint. But brother, please listen to me. What is my standpoint, what I want to say? All right, you have put up your thing, but what do I think about it? Now give me a chance, listen to me. So, the idea there is that my mind is sometimes boiling because my old sanskaras are such, for example, that if somebody provokes me, I feel that I must strike back, but I must restrain. Then only I become a yogi. By practice of it again and again, then only I will be able to change my sanskaras. So if I cannot completely hold, or I think there is no need of completely holding, it requires explanation, clarification. I must tell him because he has misunderstood, there is some wrong impression. Let me wipe it out, let it make clear. Then I should use a language with some restraint, you see. So then I should be able to control my mind, to rule my mind, to command my mind. Okay, speak something, but with restraint. Balance, patience, sweetness. That is what restraint means. Don't just burst out. Not in an uncivilized way. You must not lose your royalty, your dignity. You are the child of God. How should your actions be? If he is behaving in a different way, that is reflecting his personality. What should your personality be? You should be mindful of that. So I restrain myself. This is the power to rule. Then another one is to stop. It is different from holding and restraint. Totally stop. Absolutely no other thought. Maybe that previously I was saying, I am a soul. I am a point of light. Shiv Baba is there. This is Paramdham. I am having these thoughts. So I am holding only to these thoughts. No other thoughts. Holding only to these thoughts. But what I mean by stopping is stopping all thoughts. Just going into the experience stage. Experiential stage. Feel the bliss. Sometimes when you see someone, certain thoughts come up in your mind. But at other times it so happens that you just are in a state of ecstasy. You just be in that ecstatic stage, a blissful stage. Have an experience of it, you see. Even this repeating, like someone giving commentary and my mind working along the commentary, having some kind of a restraint, that is it. Not thinking of other things. But just when you want to stop, stop. These are great powers. Ultimately, if we develop those powers, if there is raining, I say stop. The clouds must stop. they say of Saint Francis, the sparrows were chirping and he was offering prayers. They were making lot of noise. And they say, he said, stop. And they stopped. If I can stop my mind, I can stop others also. You know that Yuri Zeller, who came to London, he, in a particular determined mind, resolved mind, you see, would concentrate his mind and would say, all the clocks and watches, wall clocks, hand watches, wrist watches, so on and so forth, stop, stop. Even the watch stops, and we cannot stop even human beings, not even the dogs, you see. If they bark, they keep barking, we cannot stop them, you see. Because we have not yet developed that power, when we think, stop, they should stop. Even the running train should stop. But we are not using those powers for these, because otherwise we are going out of our way to wrong paths, misusing our powers, trying to show miracles to the people. These powers can be attained. They come as a result of all this. But those people are using it for just tamasha, showing it to people and making their livelihood, earning something. If no money, at least name and fame. But we don't want all this thing. We want people to tell them how to stop the mind on Shiv Bhava or in meditation so as to gain that blissful experience. That is where we stop. But we should be able to stop. That should be the ruling power, you see. Then another is, let go. Let go. Let it go. Someone is saying foolish things, abusing, insulting, crying at the top of his voice, crying hoarse, you see, using rubbish language, everything. I just smile and I say, let it go. I should be able to do this. Let it go. Baba says, dekhte hue bhi mat dekho, sunte hue bhi na suno. Even when you see, you sometimes feel that you don't see. You are hearing what this man is saying, but as if you are not hearing, you see. How is it that I hear and then I also don't hear? How can both the things be at the same time, you see? To move and not to move, how is it possible? At the same instant of time. But in this case, it means you let it go. Arre jaane do bhai, chalne do. Chhodo isko, ye pagal aadmi hai. You say this man has come some screw loose in his mind, you see. And I have no screwdriver to make it tight, you see. Whatever, so let it go. Useless, why waste my time, my breath, my words, my energy, my time? I lose my royalty, my dignity. Why should I follow this man? He is not my leader, you see. Let him go. So, to let go, you rule your mind and say, let go. People sometimes do so many wrong things, and you, out of your mercy, forgive them. You can't forgive them if you have no command on your mind and you don't let things go. You will say, why should I let it go? Hang him. He did this very bad thing. He should be punished. So, sir, what punishment he should be given? He should be hanged. You see, that also is a ruling power. You see, because when you want to start something, you can ask people to start his process of hanging, you see. That also is start. But here in this case, you say, in a fit of anger, without understanding the consequences, or maybe his intention was not this. This poor fellow has done this something wrong. Instead of hanging him, give him life imprisonment. And if he shows good behavior during this period, after 10 years, maybe after 8 years, you remit his imprisonment and let him free, you see. This is what is called love and law combined, you see. How can love and law be combined? Unless and until we let it go. Let it go. Even in our spiritual institutions, centers, spiritual families, some people do certain wrong things. we do take actions against him. But sometimes we say, let it go. This poor fellow, because of his old bad sanskara, has done something very nefarious, very bad, no doubt. But where will he go? There is no other place, you see. At least he is sincere, he has confessed. And he wants somebody to help him out of this situation. It is beyond him. But his mind wants to attain that thing, freedom from this. So we say, let it go. Jaane do bhai. Is dafa chhod do ise. That is what we say. So this ruling power is to let it go. Then also to take action. A ruler must also take action. If he just says, let it go, everything, let it go, then he can't be the ruler. You see. Ruler must know how to rule. Sometimes he has to take action. He has even to punish, you see. He has to do justice. Somebody has done grave injustice to somebody. Cruel person has been killing indiscriminately anyone who comes his way. And we can't say, let it go, you see. It's not a small thing, let it go. Must take some exemplary action so that others don't follow him. That should be our approach. That we have to do. So, to take action. Take action. In our case, there are many things on which we don't take action. Baba asks us to do this, to do that, to do it. We postpone things. We put them aside. We don't take action. Certain things which require immediate action. Some files which have the label at once. Others have immediate, you see. Others urgent. So on and so forth. Showing what category of case it is. So on. We are not taking any action. And in the meantime, the result is so bad, you see. The things go worse than before. The situation goes out of hand. So the ruler is one who must be awake, must take action. Not only action, timely action, proper action, strong action, exemplary action. Because he has to rule. People should know there is a king. If we do something wrong, he will take notice of it. And he will give us punishment. If they think that he is a person who says every time, let it go, then they will say, do anything, whatever you want to do. He will ultimately say, let it go. You see. Can't be a king. He can be a Jain sadhu. He cannot be a king. If you want to be a king, different from a sadhu, you see, from someone who is just a recluse, a hermit. A hermit is someone different. But you are a ruler to govern. So, wherein lies the governance? When the kings come to the court, to the darbar, someone announces, His Majesty the King. And they say so many titles before his name. He comes. Everybody stands up. Must stand up. Because he is the king. They stand up. And then after he has taken his seat, then only they sit. And they have to talk gracefully. In the presence of the king, they can't laugh wildly. They can't do certain things in an unparliamentary or undivine or unroyal ways. They have to observe the laws of the court. When the king, his majesty, his highness is there, there has to be a particular kind of an atmosphere there. That shows that he is a king. Otherwise, what is the difference between a king and an ordinary person? You see. Similarly, you should have dignity, some kind of a royalty, a divinity, and you should be able to take action, notice of it. You need not always be told by people. You just see and you notice what is happening. Open eyes, the bullseye. They say the bullseye. The king should have, he should be able to observe what is happening. He should be aware of what is happening where and then take proper action. So there should be power of administration. to rule the others. Here also, while you are a spiritual person, a yogi, there are some people with whom you have to work in a team. The captain has to do the work of a captain. The center in charge is the center in charge. The regional in charge, or what you call RCOs, are RCOs. The head of the institution is an head of the institution. And there should be a proper protocol that must be observed. And the person who has got that stage should be observing this, whether it is happening like that. Then only that person is the ruling power. Then only that person will become the ruler in the next world. Though there you don't require this kind of thing, but this kind of ability has to be developed so that at the subtle level, it works there. People, it's not that they would be afraid of you, but your very presence will inspire in them some kind of a discipline, self-control. Here, there are laws, rules and regulations which people have to observe. But in their case, there will not be any written rules and regulations. But there are some people who are very graceful, very majestic in their gait, in their walking, in their talking, in their seeing, in their behavior, that all people want to, they feel, like Baba said in his biography, whenever he used to tell us about his life, that when kings came to him, or when he was with the kings, they would say, God has committed one blunder. Dada Lekh Raj, God has committed one blunder, we know. He might be committing other blunders, we don't know. But one blunder we are aware he has committed. What is that blunder, you remember? He said, actually you should be the king, not we. You should be the king. But he made us the king and he made you the jeweler. He has made this mistake, they used to say. Because Baba had that royalty of manners, those kingly habits, you see, those graceful ways of doing things. So that the words came from their mouth, the kings themselves saying that actually you should be the king instead of us. And they went even to the extent of saying that God committed this blunder, you see. So we should also take action. It's not that sleep over things, doing nothing. Now, just a few minutes. Very often we say that we want to have this because Baba says this. We are very aware of it. We very much feel that we should attain this stage and so on, these powers. But what should we do? You see, we are paying attention. Attention. I asked many persons, after Baba gave this Murli, is there some change in your life? Do you feel that after getting this Murli from Baba, you feel that it has changed you in some way? You feel some betterment? Many of them gave the answer, yes. I said, what is that? They said, now we are paying more attention. That's all. More attention. I asked them, what do you mean by attention? What attention you are paying? On what you are paying attention? What is that on which you are paying your attention? That they were not clear. No doubt, first of all, we have to pay attention. But attention on what? You see, you want to catch a thief. In my childhood days, generally the thief, you see, used some, the black powder. He rubbed the black powder with oil on his body. Just use a linen cloth, and in the night when it would be completely dark, they would go and steal things, pilfer things from people's houses. That was one way of the thieves going to some people's houses. In the darkness they could not be seen, but they could perhaps see, they had the cat's eyes, they could see. So one of my class fellows, my friends, and he said, today I was sitting on my father's shop and I saw the thief, you see. I said, he must not be a thief if you have seen him. What do we mean by that? Because he had heard that thieves are black. You see, thieves are black, totally black. So that, just as they say, you cannot find a black cat in a black, dark room, you know, when absolutely there is no light. So that is how the thieves come. What was happening was there were black sheep going in front of his shop. And he told his father, "Father, father, thieves are going, thieves are going." You see, his father was astonished. He said, "Where are the thieves?" He said, "But these are the thieves, don't you see?" He said, "Oh no, these are the lambs, the sheep." He said, "But somebody told me that the thieves are black, you see, and they are also black, so they are thieves, you see." So he did not understand what thieves are like, what thieves do. He just understood only one thing, because the method which they adopted to steal things, you see. So you pay your attention. Pay your attention on what? You see. So I think these are some of the things on which we have to pay attention in order to have these ruling powers. One is, I find Baba says, Ichha Matram Avidya. The whole cause of trouble, the root cause of trouble is our ambition. Over ambitious. Those who are over ambitious, they come into conflict with others. They compete badly with others. And that competition, that ambition, high ambition, leads them to jealousy. And after leading them to jealousy, it leads them to hate those people who are attaining something when he is not attaining. He hates them. And when he hates, then is born anger in his mind about those people. And then he begins to denounce them and tell lies, you see. So the trouble starts from being over ambitious. And therefore Baba said, Ichha Matram Avidya. You should have no desires. Okay, without desires we can't be. Some desires are necessary. Without life, that life would be no more. But what I mean to say is, we should not be ambitious. Even if you want to have some ambition, good ambition, okay, have it. But don't be over ambitious, because that is the cause of whole turmoil. That will lead you to conflict. When you say there were no negative thoughts or there were negative thoughts, what do you mean? The negative thoughts are of three kinds. If you just make the groups of negative thoughts, what are the negative thoughts about? Either the negative thoughts are about some persons with whom you have conflict, who misbehaved with you or whom you don't like, they are not nice to you, they forget that you helped them in their days and so on. So because of one reason or the other, you have not good relations with somebody, some people, and they come to your mind again and again, and you feel bad about it, and therefore you say that you have had negative thoughts. That is one thing, one group of thoughts, negative thoughts. The other is your sanskaras, you see. Sometimes there is no reason for you are being in a serious mood or for losing your mood, but some sanskara comes up in your mind and you get bad taste in it. So that brings negative thoughts in it. Then the other is that you take notice of the failures, the shortcomings, the minus points, the dark points in others, their weaknesses, you see. When you always have the habit of noticing the other's weaknesses, then you have negative thoughts. You don't like them. You hate them. And then hate again brings you misbehavior with them. Then again you repent, I did not do something which was good, and so on. It leads to a chain of certain thoughts. So this again is something. So what I wanted to say was that you should pay attention to these things. One is that you should pay attention to having no over-ambitiousness, and therefore you should be free from jealousy, hatred, all these negative thoughts. Then another important thing is some three or more, four more points. One is routine violation. When you don't do things. So I was saying that one of the other things is that we violate our routine. Either we don't get up at Amrit Vela, or we don't observe traffic control properly, or we don't, while offering our bhog or food to Baba, remain in his awareness, in his consciousness. We don't meditate during the evening. We don't read Murli daily. So certain instructions have been given to us by Baba, which form a part of our daily routine. So we may be violating that routine. So daily, we disobey Baba a number of times. Morn till evening, we disobey Baba. You just tell me, if you disobey someone for years, day after day, will he give you his inheritance when you are disobeying a disobedient person? You see. And that also not just by chance or by due to certain reasons or for a day or two, but for so many days and months and years. If one violates this, what will be the result? So this is done. Then another is that we don't realize. Baba says you should have realization and determination. We just don't make up our mind, we must do it. We are not having that strong resolve. We are just, thinking that we will do it, but not so particular about it, not feeling any zealous, any zeal about it. So that is one of the reasons. Then we don't say that he is Karan Karavanhar, that whatever he is getting done, I am just an instrument, and it is all his work, his grace. The work of re-establishment of golden aged world is his. I am just a small instrument in that work. Actually, it all is being done by him, the Lord Almighty. I forget this. And therefore, I do not make proper efforts. And when I don't make proper efforts, Baba says, Himmat e marda madad e khuda. If you just help yourselves, then God also helps you. If you don't make any efforts, how can God help you? So since we don't make any sincere efforts, so Shiv Baba also does not help us. Our sanskaras may have been bad. We may be weak in many subjects. But let us make sincere effort. And Baba says, I will help you. The only condition is that you must make sincere efforts. I will help you. That is his promise, his guarantee. But the efforts have to come from you. If we do this, we pay attention to this. These are the things to which we have pay attention. When we pay attention to this, then we can attain the stages which I just said. Thank you. Om Shanti.